Good morning, church. He is risen. He is risen indeed. Amen. Let's all stand together.
Of the Lord, isn't it? Amen. I want to say thank you real quick to the men who came and fixed our breakfast today. At one time, I counted 18 of us in there around the kitchen working together, and that was a good crew and a lot of fun. Thank you, guys, and I hope it was a worthwhile meal for you who enjoyed that. Coming up real soon, May 17th and 18th is our Cactus Weekend, and it's a work and witness trip. If that's a strange phrase to you, Cactus Weekend, what's that mean? It's not a prickly little sticky thing. It's a ministry down in Texas that our people will be going to. So please do sign up in the foyer. That's very important. Now we have a save the date, another missions thing, and this is going to be a lot of fun. I was glad to see this come up. A missions night, Sunday, May 5th, 5 o'clock. A taco supper. Now, that's just going to be good, right? Taco supper and auction. Well, going once. Let's go on twice to the next one. Tithes and offerings. You know what? We have such an awesome church. You're so good about this. But on occasion, I get reminded, maybe there's somebody who's new since we changed systems and they're not sure how to give or where to give or when or why. There's offering boxes in the back. There's one over there on the north side of the sound booth. There's one on the wall by the doors as you exit on the south end. There's also a mail slot by our church administrator's office there in the hallway. So you can drop your offerings in there and with a prayer because it is an act of worship. That's the awesome part, right? We don't often mention that near enough. That is an act of worship. So do that. But if you want to use the Tithely and all the electronic things that you can do that on the internet, that's great too. Or you can just bring it by in the weekday and say, I forgot to give this and leave it there, and we'll be glad to do that and bless you. All right, speaking of offerings, we're trying to raise some funds because our gym is in need of repair, and we've been announcing this a little bit. Let's see where that bar graph stops at. Ooh-wee, are you kidding? That's awesome. Somebody want to say amen? Amen. Outstanding. We want to get started on that just as quick as some contractors will get here as soon as school is out, and there'll be a new floor, and the walls will be replaced, and carpet added to that. That'll help with some audio problems, echoes, etc., some insulation that has to be replaced, some things for the ceiling so it'll look more attractive, and so it's going to be really, really worthwhile, and it'll be a good thing to get done. So with that said, we want to watch a video this morning, short. So don't think you're going to have time to run and get popcorn. Not that kind of video, but watch this clip concerning our Lord Jesus Christ and resurrection.
It had been 3 long days. The echoes of the cross still filled the air. There was a darkness that was palpable, a sense of dread that was all-consuming. Fear permeated the landscape, powered by an inconceivable loss. Hope was dead. But in the distance was a sound. The sound of earth moving, of foundations rattling. The sound of God taking back the world he loved. Darkness had been flooded with light. Fear had been overtaken by hope. Death had been swallowed in victory. In that moment, sin lost its power. The grave lost its sting, and evil was left broken in defeat. He is victorious. He is triumphant. He is risen. Jesus is alive.
Thank the Lord that he has risen today, and because of his amazing grace, he's available for each one of us. The veil has been torn, and we can have direct access to Jesus Christ and God himself, and that's wonderful. So let's all stand today and continue singing and worshiping. This is Amazing Grace. Amen.
Take my place. the sun forbear to shine, but God who called me here below will be forever mine, will be forever mine. You are forever mine.
You may be seated.
Into the hands of his enemies. He will be killed, but 3 days later, he will rise from the dead.
The resurrection is not merely important to the historic Christian faith. Without it, there would be no Christianity. It is the singular doctrine that elevates Christianity above all other world religions.
We live and die. Christ died and lived.
The resurrection completes the inauguration of God's kingdom. It is the decisive event demonstrating that God's kingdom really has been launched on earth as it is in heaven. The message of Easter is that God's new world has been unveiled in Jesus Christ and that you're now invited to belong to it.
He defeated death and made the ultimate sacrifice so our sins could be forgiven.
The birth, death, and resurrection of Jesus means that one day everything sad will come untrue.
The evidence for the resurrection of Jesus Christ is more powerful than anything else we believe. By his resurrection, Jesus proved he is who he says he is.
We have a God that is all-powerful that can raise me to new life as well.
Genesis ends with Joseph's death. Deuteronomy ends with Moses' death. Joshua ends with Joshua's death. The Gospels end with Jesus' resurrection, and that changes everything.
The earliest Christians believed in the resurrection, not because they couldn't find a dead body, but because they found a living Christ.
The resurrection is the absolute vindication of sacrificial, nonviolent enemy love.
Years ago, in the Middle East, an event occurred that permanently changed the world. Because of that event, history was split. Every time you write a date, you're using the resurrection of Jesus Christ as a focal point.
A fool like me gets redeemed by the sacrifice of the Son of the Creator of the universe, and you want me to keep that to one sentence?
The resurrection of Jesus and his victory over all the sin, guilt, fear, and shame that the enemy would use to condemn us gives me the freedom to live for Jesus instead of living for me and trying to earn my way to him.
The resurrection was the Father's amen to Jesus saying, "It is finished."
Amen. The resurrection meant first that Christ was undeniably God. He was what he claimed to be. Christ was deity in the flesh.
The resurrection of Jesus represents God's power over sin and death. It means the gift of an abundant life, both now and forever, which was given out of a deep love for all people, including myself. And it is the ultimate display of God's authority as Jesus reigns not just over me, but in me.
Everyone, would you join me in saying this morning?
He is risen.
He is risen indeed.
When hope is just a distant thought, you take my pain and you lead me to the cross. What love is this that you gave your life for me?
Confess, you're always enough for me.
Okay, church, let's stand together and continue singing.
Shed for me. There's no greater love than this. You have overcome the grave. Your glory fills the highest place. What can separate me?
Last song I'd like to just sing as a song of praise and worship for the holy God that we serve.
And generations falling down in worship to sing a song of ages to the Lamb.
Amen.
And all who've gone before us and all who will believe will sing the song of ages to the Lamb. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all, and the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. If you've been forgiven, and if you've been redeemed, sing the song forever the Lamb. And if you walk in freedom, and if you bear his name, sing the song forever to the Lamb. We'll sing the song forever and amen. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings, holy. The greatest, your name stands above them all. dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. Your name is the highest, your name is the greatest, your name stands above them all. All thrones and dominions, all powers and positions, your name stands above them all. And the angels cry, holy, all creation cries, holy, you are lifted high, holy, holy forever. Hear your people sing, holy, to the King of Kings, holy, you will always be, holy, holy forever. You will always be holy forever.
Amen. He is holy. Amen. Amen. You may be seated.
Thank you so much for that worship singing this morning. How awesome it is to worship our God together, and those beautiful words and themes presented in that message. That's just fantastic. We want to pray this morning, and I would like for you to especially pray as we get to this moment of preaching God's Word. There is nothing more powerful than the Word of God. And I want to be sure that we get it right. Father, thank you so much for this incredible event that we get to celebrate the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who gave himself to die for us. But he knew all along, in just 3 days he'd be back. And Father, today we are so glad to serve a risen Savior. I'm so glad that we don't have a memorial service, but a celebration of a risen Savior. So today, speak to our hearts. May your words come alive to our spirit and our soul, as you did in the Scriptures. Father, open our minds so that we can understand them plainly, clearly, joyfully, and know the power of God that we enjoy this day. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. The message today has four parts. It's going to be pretty easy. I think you'll remember this. Arrive, alive, survive, and revive. It has to do with the ladies arriving at the tomb. And then, shortly after that, they realize that Jesus is alive. While they were having a good time because they knew the truth of it, some others left their little meeting, not believing Jesus had been raised from the dead, and they were so broken, they were just trying to survive. But when they realized the truth themselves, that Jesus was alive, they were revived in their soul and spirits. And so that's the message today in a nutshell, and let's get started. Luke chapter 24 is where we're at in the Word of God. I'm preaching this morning from the New American Standard Bible, and there's a reason for that. We'll get to it in just a little bit. And so at verse 24, the Bible tells us, on the first day of the week at early dawn, they came to the tomb, bringing the spices which they had prepared. You probably remember, I think we mentioned this last week, that Jesus was buried in haste, because it was a high holy day and the sun was setting and they didn't have time to go through the whole rituals of a Jewish funeral. So they came back on this day to prepare his body for burial. They were doing this thing. It was natural for them, and they were coming to finish up this process for one they dearly loved. And they fully expected to find a dead body. because they had seen Jesus crucified. They were there when he breathed his last and gave up his spirit. They saw his body wrapped in linen, and they saw him placed in this tomb. They saw the stone moved in place. It was final. It was over, wrapped up and sealed up. And I'm sure these ladies were sad and brokenhearted at the thought of their friend, their Lord, their Savior, the one they loved, die. And yet they came to give Jesus a proper burial, to anoint his body with spices, and in doing that, put their own lives at risk. I say put their lives at risk because it was very possible that the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees, the professional religious guys, the temple guards, maybe even the Romans, somebody might want to come and put a final squash to this thing and be sure nobody dared mention the name of Jesus again. So I would ask, what drove them to risk going out to where Jesus was buried? I would insist the answer to that is a love for Jesus. Every great thing that's happened in my life has been either for love for Donna and our kids or love for Jesus. And maybe it's that way with you. I hope it is. That the motivating factor that gets you up in the morning, puts a smile on your face, and victory in your soul is because you love Jesus. That's a pretty good deal. When you came to Jesus, you either came knowing that he had been raised again, or you had a very desperate hope that he did, and a very strong hope that he was alive, because you had some degree of desperation to find forgiveness of your sins and renewal of your life. Maybe there's somebody listening today who hasn't found that. Convict us of our sins and at the forgiveness of our sins because Jesus died. Forgiveness of our sins because Jesus died and rose. Says when they entered, verse 3, they did not find the body of the Lord Jesus. Amen. Amen. They were perplexed. Now we have it in hindsight. We've read the scriptures. We've been saved. We've been told the story. But they were there in person as it was unraveling, as it was unfolding, while it happened. They were perplexed about this. And then the Bible says, behold, and folks, I don't mean to wear you out with that word, but now there's a sudden dramatic change. Something is about to happen that's going to change them forever. And suddenly, two men stood near them in dazzling clothing. I don't remember what it was, probably a Christmas play a couple years ago. Some of the kids had dazzling angel costumes on. Do you remember seeing that? And the lights would hit it just right, and it would sparkle and shine. It almost looked like it had lights coming from the inside out. I imagine these angels were dressed somewhat like that, and the Bible says that these women were terrified, and they bowed with their faces to the ground, but the men said to them, now this is the great part, folks, listen to this. Why do you seek the living one among the dead? I'm going to camp on this just for a bit because Jesus is still alive, and I want us to get this. We have an absolute positive, joyful message today, glorious good news that Jesus is alive. Of all the people that are worshipped, of all the statues that are worshipped, of all the things people do for religion, Jesus is the only one that died for us and is alive again. We've got such good news. We ought to camp on that every day. When we wake up in the morning, we ought to think about that first and know that he's with us. When you've had a horrible, 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 rotten day, you ought to go to bed at night at least thinking, well, at least Jesus is still alive. My tractor might have died. My truck might have died. My dog might have died. But Jesus is alive. And we have this day today not as a memorial, but as a day of celebration. So hallelujah, amen, thank you, Jesus. That excites me so much, I think that if I were Pentecostal, I'd be speaking Chinese about now with an Okie accent. I'd just throw that in there. I'm excited to know that my Savior's alive. So praise God, he's coming back for me. Now, I'm preaching today, as I said, from the New American Standard Version of the Bible. And there's only a few like it that translate this verse in the way this one did, saying, why do you seek the living one among the dead? I grew up reading other Bibles, and you did too. I'll bet that it just simply said, why do you seek the living among the dead? There's nothing horribly wrong with that. But there's a reason, a good reason, why it should be translated as saying, the living one, as if to say, we know that you're looking for Jesus, the risen King, the Lord of glory, the one who died but is alive forevermore. Why do you seek the living one? And why does it say the living one and not just the living? Well, not a horrible translation, but let's take a closer look. Ask yourself this. How many people do you know that have died for someone else, maybe died for you? Not many. But of all of those who have died for someone else, might have been a soldier, might have been a policeman, might have been a firefighter. How many of them were able to say, I'm going to die for you this week, but in 3 days I'll come back? I don't think we can come up with very many people who have said that. In fact, I can think of exactly one. Jesus didn't prophesy only that he would die for us, but he said, I will come back. I'll be alive again 3 days later. One, only one person died for our sins and rose from the dead. That was Jesus Christ, the Son of God. So we're here today to celebrate him. Celebrate Jesus. But check this out. There's more. The living one. This phrase in itself. So we're going to break it down into some grammar. And no, I'm not smart enough to know all of this on my own. I'm just smart enough to find a good book that explains this to me. Let's look at this. The living one. Living is a verb. It's a verb. That means that that word denotes action, right? Keep that in mind. Not only is it action, but the verb is given in present tense. That represents a statement of fact or reality viewed as happening in actual time, real time, right now, happening now. He's living. He's the living one, and he's living right now in present tense. Furthermore, this just gets better the more you unfold it, folks. The voice is in the active sense, active. That means that the subject is the doer or performer of the action. Jesus is the subject and the action, he's alive. He's the one that gave his life for us, and he took action on that and came back to life. John 10:10 says this, the reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life in order to take it up again. No one takes my life from me. I had a hard time figuring that out when I was a kid. I used to hate the Romans, or I would hate the Jews, or I would hate the sinners. I would hate somebody. I'd say, they killed my Lord. And then I came across this verse, and it just slowly had to kind of percolate in my spirit, my soul, and my mind, and I finally realized they didn't just take him and kill him. He laid his life down in order to take it up again. No one takes it from me. I lay it down of my own accord. Now listen to this. I have authority to lay it down, and authority to take it up again. Ha, amen. The subject is the doer of the action. Jesus is the subject, and he performed the action. He laid down his life. He took it up again to be alive forevermore. How many people get to say that? I can think of one, just one. So why do you seek the living one among the dead? What are you doing? What are you doing here? Did you come to a funeral or something? This isn't a funeral scene, folks. This is a celebration. But wait, there's one more. In the grammar, there's a thing called a participle. In this case, because it's present tense, the participle ends in ing, meaning he's not just alive, he's living. Right now, present tense, actively doing it, living, breathing, he is alive, and you're seeking the living one, actively, presently, living even as we speak. And the song reminds us, I serve a risen Savior. He's in the world today. I know that he is living, whatever men may say. I see his hand of mercy. I hear his voice of cheer. And just the time I need him, he's always near. He lives. He lives. We ought to rewrite the hymn. He's living. He's living. Christ Jesus is living today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives. He lives salvation to impart. You ask me how I know he lives, and you know the answer. He lives in my heart. If you haven't found salvation from your sins yet, he's still making the offer today. If you haven't found that Jesus is alive and well and interceding for you and me, I got good news. The offer still stands today. Today, while it's still salvation, today, that Jesus rose from the dead and he offers you that same life to become alive in Christ. So the angels went on to say to them, he is not here, but he is risen. And then they said this, remember, has anybody ever said that to you? Remember, as if you knew something, but then you forgot. I think I hear that a lot. Dad, don't you remember? Tom, don't you remember? My parents would say, Tom, don't you remember? And the angel said to him, don't you remember how he spoke to you while he was still with you in Galilee? And he said, the Son of Man must be delivered into the hands of sinful men and be crucified and the third day rise again. And verse 8 says, and they remembered his words. Now, I'm not throwing stones at these ladies. I'm not throwing stones at the disciples. But it just seems too weird to me. I don't quite understand this. How do you hear a message so amazing that I'm going to die for you, but then in 3 days I'm going to come back to life? Wouldn't you think that would be something hard to forget? But with all that was going on and the gruesome scene and the horrible, horrible death they saw on the cross, I'm sure that just must have shocked their senses. And how could they possibly think of anything else other than I just saw my best friend beaten to death, whipped to death, scourged to death. And it was the most horrible, bloody scene they probably ever had witnessed in their life. Somehow they did not remember that Jesus said all of this would happen. And 3 days later, but how can you forget that? Oh, I don't know, but Jesus loved them so much, he didn't take it against them. He didn't hold it against them. He still loved them. He's still reaching out his hands to you and I saying, see this? See this right here in my hand? That's the scar of love just for you. They went back and they told all their friends what the angel had said. And being just the skeptics that they were, they didn't believe it. They just couldn't believe it. But do you know what I can tell you for a fact? In spite of the fact that his chosen disciples, that inner circle, even they couldn't believe it, but he still loved them. He said, I've got patience. Hang on, boys. You'll see. You'll come around. These words seem to them like nonsense. Peter, bless his heart, even if he wasn't a believer, at least he was an honest skeptic, and he ran to see for himself. And sure enough, there were only empty linen wrappings. And he walked away just in amazement at what might have happened. Now, we've got to the arrive and then alive, and now we get to the survive part. I got to tell you, this blesses me. A couple of lesser-known disciples were on their road to Emmaus. They were going home after this day of amazing stories, and they just couldn't make sense of it. And they were depressed and discouraged and at the same time hopeful, but then something would pop that hope balloon, and the next thing you know, they just said, well, it can't be. That just doesn't make sense. So without the full assurance of faith and without the knowledge of a living Savior, the best they could do is just try to survive one more day. Depressed, discouraged, defeated, demoralized. The looks on their faces, I can't hardly quite tell you what it would be like. So the closest I can come is the looks on the faces of the team that loses a big championship. And they were expected to win. Maybe they were winning all through the game. And in the last second, the other team pulls out an unbelievable victory. A come from behind. Nobody saw that coming. Especially the other team, they thought they had the championship in the bag, and then all the confetti was in the other team's colors, and the balloons, and all the cheering was for the other guys, And they sat on the field, stunned, disbelief. Can't believe what just happened. And that might have been the looks on these guys' face. And now I got to tell you, I'm going to do it again. The Bible says, and behold. Man, that's such a big word in the Bible. It's becoming my favorite word. Behold. Why is that so amazing? Because when things are so terrible and God says, behold, it means I'm about to do something amazing. Watch again. Don't blink. If you miss it, I'll replay it for you. But watch. Something dramatic is about to happen. There's about to be a huge event in this world's history. And these people who thought they were losers just found out that there was an instant replay, and rather than losing, they were actually the winners. Can you imagine? Wait, let's see that tape again. Replay it. Oh, look, he did cross the goal line. They won. And these guys who thought they had lost the big one are just about to find out they were in fact winners. Jesus was the champion after all. And their lives are about to drastically change forever by the presence of the one they thought was dead. They were headed to Emmaus. Emmaus means something like warm baths or hot baths. I suspect there might have been a hot spring there. We used to live up at Chandler, Nebraska, just across the state line from South Dakota, and right up there was a little town called Hot Springs. It was called Hot Springs for a reason. They had a big indoor structure there, like a swimming pool, just bubbling all the time with hot springs. People went there from long, long ways away. A good place to go and just relax. Can you imagine? These guys stressed out because their friend Jesus had just been horribly crucified. And they thought he was dead, and they were so stressed, and maybe they thought a soak in a hot spring might help the tensions a little bit. And they were talking with each other about all these things that had taken place, and while they were walking and talking, Jesus himself approached and began to travel with them. I've got good news for you today. About the time that you get down, and about the time that you think life is broken, about the time you think that all your resources are gone, that friends can't be found, your health is gone, and you feel alone and defeated, and your past comes back to haunt you, Jesus himself comes to walk with you. Isn't that good news? You're not alone at all. Not at all. For Jesus would say amen to that. When you think this old wobbly old world has just gone down the tubes and you say, well, at least Jesus is alive. And he's going to say, that's right, I am. Well, of course, Jesus could walk with them and talk with them because he was alive. But their eyes were prevented from recognizing him. I have to ask, you got to pause for this question. What has got you so discouraged these days that you're kept from recognizing Jesus is with you? What's going on in your life that is so horrible that you can't find the joy of the Lord? What's so terrible in life that a living Savior doesn't bring a smile to your face? And he said to them, what are these words that you're exchanging with one another as you're walking along? And they stood still, and the Bible says, and looked sad. Sadness. They thought that Jesus' teachings were now a thing of the past. His miracles were over. The joy was gone. And these brothers were just trying to survive. One of them said, are you the only one visiting Jerusalem, unaware of these things which have happened here in these days? Do you not know anything? Isn't that kind of beyond belief? That they thought that Jesus was a visitor to his own crucifixion? They thought Jesus was unaware of his own crucifixion. How silly is that? And he said to them, what things? And he, you know what, I wonder sometimes if Jesus wasn't just messing with them a little bit. I wonder sometimes when my prayers don't get answered real fast if God's just messing with me a little bit. I said, come on, Tom, I was just teasing. I was going to answer all along. I was just waiting to see if you'd trust me. What things? And he knew what they were talking about. He knew why they were sad. Here's the good news for you and I today. Jesus knows what's getting us down. It's no surprise to him. He was fully human as we are. He knows how life can be. He knows about it. So you might as well confess and say, look, I know you know all about this, so help me get this figured out if you would please. And so they said the things about Jesus the Nazarene, who was a prophet mighty in deed and word and in the sight of God and all the people, and how the chief priests and our rulers delivered him to the sentence of death and crucified him. But listen to this. But we were hoping, other translations say it this way, we had hoped. We don't have hope today. It's gone. All hope is lost. But we had hope, we were hoping that he was the one that was going to redeem Israel. And indeed, besides all this, it's the third day since he was crucified, and some of our ladies said they'd gone to the tomb and he wasn't there, and an angel met them and said that he had been resurrected, but our people went back to the tomb and they didn't see him anywhere. We don't know what to do with all of this. He said to them, oh, foolish men, that means not understanding, slow of heart to believe in all that the prophets had spoken, was it not necessary? And I want to tell you today, it was necessary for Christ to suffer those things. Because had he not done that, no sacrifice would have washed away our sins. Animals could have never, I don't care how many you sacrifice, animals couldn't cleanse your heart of sin. It was necessary that Jesus do this for you. And as they approached the village where they were going, he acted, again, I guess kind of messing with him, he acted as though if he was going to go farther. I suppose he still had more people to see. He didn't stay long, but while he was there, the Bible says it was getting toward evening and the day was nearly over. So they said, please stay with us. The day's about past. Please stay with us. I just have to ask if there's somebody who would be here today or listening on the internet who would say, I want Jesus to stay with me. My days are about past. Life's getting pretty dark about right now. This wobbly old world is getting to be a pretty dark place to live. And I don't want Jesus to leave. I want him to live with me forever. My life is about past. Can't you stay? Jesus, please come in and stay. And so the Bible says he went in to stay with them. And when he reclined at the table, I like the way Jesus just moves into a person's heart and does the right thing and takes charge. When he reclined at the table with them, he took the bread. The host should have taken the bread and divided it up, but he took the bread and blessed it. And breaking it, he began to give it to them. And then their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. And about the time they knew it was Jesus, can you imagine? They want to give him a hug, and he disappears. Oh, that would have been disappointing. But still, they knew he was alive. And so what they do, they got up and they ran fast as they could back to Jerusalem. Because as they testified, were our hearts not burning within us while he was speaking to us on the road and explaining the scriptures? I want to ask you this morning, does your heart just burn to hear more of God speaking to you, to hear the Holy Spirit say, son, daughter, listen, I'm for you. I've got a blessing for you, and I have a way to fix this mess you're in. I just need you to surrender your life to me. And there's something about it when the Lord speaks to us in such a loving way, our hearts just burn for more of it. I want to hear from God. I hear from some great people, I hear from some good songs, and I hear from some good news now and then, and that's all wonderful, but I want to hear from heaven. Even if God has to convict me of something and say, Tom, you were wrong, I want to hear from heaven. I want to hear from the Holy Spirit straight from God to say, Tom, let's get this straight now, let's get our act together, let's do better. Oh, my heart burns to hear the Lord speak to me, and I want to hear him say one of these days, well done, good and faithful servant. So between now and that day, I want to walk close with him. I want to be in his word, and I want to hear from him. Because the Lord, as they ran back and they shared with their friends, the Lord has risen. He's alive. He's alive today. And they began to relate their experiences and all that had happened to. And about that time, while they were still speaking, the Bible says Jesus, he himself, the crucified one, stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be to you." He's offering you peace today. In a troubled world, in a messed up mind, in a mixed up heart, he's offering you peace. You want it? When Jesus was, before he was crucified, there were some folks that didn't like him, didn't like what he said, didn't like what he implied about the Pharisees and some of the other religious leaders. But I got to ask this question in terms of a country song. When he came back to life and he held his hands out, I wonder if he said, "Look at these scars. How do you like me now?" Isn't that pretty good? How do you like me now? Now that I've died for your sins, now that I've been raised again, now that I'm alive forevermore, now that I'm interceding for you every day, how do you like me now? You want him as your Lord? Say yes. Jesus, I want you. Please forgive me of my sins and help me to live for you. Maybe someday when I'm in heaven and I'm giving an account before God of my life and everything I've said and done, maybe I'll have enough courage to bow before you and say, "How do you like me now? Now that you've worked in my heart and you've worked in my mind and you've worked in my life, did I respond well enough that I could have the courage to say, 'How do you like me now that you've changed me?'" Amen. We want to serve communion in honor of Jesus today, the Lord's Supper. These elements are going to remind us of the body of Christ that was broken for us, and his blood that was shed for us. And this supper, the Lord's Supper, is for everyone who has said yes to Jesus and asked him to forgive them of their sins and come into their heart and life and be their Lord and Savior. You don't have to be a member of this church to receive this. You just have to be a Christian. So I'd like for those who are going to serve to come forward, please, and meet me here, be ready to do this. And while we're getting ready, if you haven't asked Christ yet to come into your heart to forgive you of your sins, do it right now while we're getting ready. And then you get to partake of the Lord's blood and body as these things represent his death for you. And do it with a new and fresh meaning. Because this is for you, and it reminds us of what he's done, and is also a memory, a token, in memory of him coming back again. Father, as we get ready to serve your communion today, we know that some people would have said it's too good to be true. But you opened their minds and you revived their spirits and their heart. And your word tells us that you instituted this Lord's Supper so that we could find a revival in it, a revived spirit in it, knowing what Jesus has done for us. So I pray, Father, that you would bless this moment. And as we receive these elements, may we be in prayer, knowing how much you've done for us. We ask in Jesus' name. Please distribute these, and I'm going to ask if you would please to hold this. Don't eat or drink it until everyone is served, and then when everybody is served, we'll receive this together. May the Lord bless you in this moment. This is the Lord's table, and this feast is for his disciples. So again, we invite all who have, with true repentance and forsaken their sins and have believed in Jesus Christ for salvation, to draw near and to take these emblems and by faith partake of the life of Jesus Christ. We pray that it would be to your soul's comfort. We'd also ask you to remember that it's a memorial of the death and the passion of our Lord and a token of his coming again. Do you remember that when Jesus was serving this meal to his disciples, and as he passed the cup, he said that he would never, ever take that cup again until it's fulfilled in his kingdom, when we're home with him? I think that's one of the reasons why on the cross, when they put wine on a sponge and put it up to his lips, he refused it. He wasn't going to take that anymore until we, the bride of Christ, are home with him. And then we'll celebrate together. Our Father, I know that it was out of your mercy and love that you gave your Son, Jesus Christ, not just to die for us, but to die a humiliating, painful death on the cross for our redemption. So we ask in all humility, Father, that as we receive these elements that represent Jesus' body and blood, as Jesus has instructed us to do, that you would help us to remember his passion, his love for us, and the death he suffered, and especially that we would be partakers, Lord, of his mercy and forgiveness and grace, and enjoy the benefits of his sacrifice. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're reminded in the same night that our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, after the supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was broken for you, may it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Take this and eat it in remembrance that Christ died for you. This cup is representative of the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, which was shed for you. May it preserve you blameless unto everlasting life. Drink this in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for you, and be thankful. One more thing here I want to mention. That the Lord had told his disciples that he was going to die for them. And he said to them that it was written that the Christ would suffer and rise again from the dead the third day, and that repentance, not just turning over a new leaf, but genuine repentance for sins and for forgiveness of sins would be proclaimed in his name, that is on the basis of what he's done for us, to all the nations, beginning in Jerusalem, and then to all the nations of the world. Then he said, "You are witnesses of these things." And truly, we are here today because through the years, somebody witnessed to somebody, and somebody witnessed to somebody, and somebody witnessed to somebody, and somebody witnessed to you. And the work goes on. So go this week in the peace and joy of Jesus, because he is alive forevermore. He's coming back to take you home with him. Might happen today, could happen tomorrow. Might not be for a year or two or 10. But be ready. And do your best to take somebody home with you. Father, bless my friends here today. May they enjoy the presence of God as we celebrate a risen Savior today around a dinner table, around the house, in the yard. May we especially enjoy our children and remind them that Jesus Christ is alive and he lives in our hearts. May they accept him too at a very young age. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.